gospel lesson for today is 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 6 through 10 and 17 through 19. There is a great gain in godliness with contentment, for we brought nothing into the world, and we cannot take anything out of the world. But if we have food and clothing, with these we shall be content. But those who desire to be rich fall into the temptation, into a snare, into many senseless and hurtful desires that plunge men into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is the root of all evils. It is through this craving that some have wandered away from their faith and pierced their hearts with many griefs. From Timothy 17 through 19, as for the rich in this world, charge them not to be arrogant, nor to set their hopes on uncertain riches, but on God, who richly furnishes us with everything to enjoy. They are to do good, to be rich in good deeds, liberal and generous, thus laying up for themselves a good foundation for the future, so that they may take hold of the life which is life indeed. Well, this is my first shot of the sermon, so bear with me. We're going to start it off a little different. I'd like you to listen to the words of this song by country music star Shania Twain, entitled Ka-Ching. Computers, junk mail, magazines. And how many times have you heard that we want our children or grandchildren to have more than we did? So what did many of us do? We worked harder, bought more things. Sure, we all want the so-called American dream, a nice car or two, a house, that big high-definition TV, your cell phone, your computer, your tablet, the list goes on. But should this be our aim in life? Or look at your job. How many of us at work had a job we really didn't like just so we could buy more things? Many people work two jobs, and today both parents have to work in many cases to afford their present lifestyles. Yet I ask you again, is it all worth it? And as stewards, would Jesus wish us to have all these things? Don't you sometimes feel that the more things you have, the more complicated life becomes? Wasn't life simpler when we did have less? Well, I feel there are four interconnected words that are far more richly rewarding than all the material things we own. And although we use these words every day, the important thing is how we use them in our daily life and how they are a big part of what goes here on here at Union Church. I call them the four C's. To expand on each one, let's start with the word compassion. Three good synonyms: empathy, sensitivity, charity. People in many cases think about their problems as they must, but we should remember three things. One, that someone always has it worse off than we do. Two, before we judge other people, we should stop and say, what if I were in that situation? And third, remember the proverbial golden rule, which has one common theme that basically states that people should treat each other as they would like to be treated. It has become a me world, and we should catch ourselves each time we start complaining about how bad things are and we don't have enough money for this or that. Aren't we all guilty of this at one time or another? Yet I see people of Union Church show their compassion in many wonderful ways, whether it is by supporting the Good Samaritan Fund, Habitat for Humanity, the food pantry, the deacons, all our church programs, or it can be as simple as being compassionate to someone before church, during fellowship hour, or throughout the year who is having some kind of difficulty or personal problem in their life. Many of us also donate our time and energy to literacy, healthcare, and other community services outside the church. I think some of the most rewarding things in life, not material things, are showing empathy, sensitivity, and being charitable. As they say, doesn't it give you more joy to give rather than to receive? The next word is compromise. Listening to one another. Come to an understanding. Make a concession. Compromise has become part of our everyday life, whether it is putting up with that boss or coworker that drives you crazy, a spouse or a significant other that doesn't want to change their mind, your children who become so angry at you because everything has to be the parents' way. Or how about letting that driver in who is trying to squeeze in front of you after you have stayed in the correct lane and waited for what seems to be an eternity when a mile back the sign said merge? Are you the person who will compromise and let them in, or are you the one who curse them? You might do both. Talk about the ultimate compromise. Just think what any president of the United States has to go through on a daily basis. Compromise at Union goes on all the time. How many times have we had to compromise in the church, you ask? To name a few examples, how about how should we best serve our local communities? How many fundraisers to have? Which hymnal to use? How many hymns to sing? How the communion service should be performed? Where and how the choir should enter and leave the sanctuary? This is one of my favorites, to clap or not to clap. The sermon was too long, or the service went over an hour. I'm sure all of us have more to add to that list. But should we look at these as deal breakers on attending church or a reason not to support our church? Remember, this is God's church, and He has given us the responsibility as stewards to carry out His will, not ours. I just want to repeat that. I just feel it's important. Remember, this is God's church, and He has given us the responsibility as stewards to carry out His will. Having been a member for 42 years, Union Church has gone through many difficult times, and we will continue to have more, because like life, nothing remains static, and with change comes adjustment. But the congregation has stayed together because we are a church family, and why? Because we have made concessions. Sure, sometimes we agree to disagree, but in the end, we've stayed united. The third word is communication. imparting or exchanging of information. In today's society, we all seem to panic at times and think, how did we get by without computers, tablets, iPads, or cell phones? Sure, they are great gadgets and do come in handy for so many things, too many to mention. But how often have we seen families or people Googling, talking, or texting and not verbally communicating with each other? At a restaurant, my wife and I saw the saddest thing. A family of four came in, all on their devices. They were seated and didn't talk till the waitress asked them for their orders. This continued through their entire dinner time, and they left the restaurant still on their devices. Why did they go out? I asked. Was that their quality time to communicate with each other? Speaking with one another makes it personal, and it brings out the true emotion one is feeling instead of keeping it inside or taking the easy way out by emailing or texting. Another example, don't we all get frustrated when we are on the phone and it says press 1, press 2, etc. And none of the options relate to what you want to express. And you have to start all over again to boot. You know that if you had talked to a real person directly instead of going through multiple options, the issue could have been resolved so much quicker and been far less frustrating for the most time. If it wasn't for communicating by listening to one another, there would be far less compromise at union. Whether it be a session, deacons, or committee meeting, Sunday morning is that time to seek sanctuary, no pun intended. By turning off the electronics for an hour or two and personally communicating with each other and God, through singing of hymns of praise, reciting the Apostles' Creed, joining together in the prayer of confession, listening to the children's moment, the sermon, the choir's introits and anthems. Or for some of us, it may be a time to communicate their thoughts silently with God. The point is that each of us get lifted up by some part of the church service, and that is what we should key on. I think we can all agree that if we stop talking to one another, then anger and frustration will eventually take over. So we should try to verbally communicate with each other about the positive and not dwell on the negative. The final and most important word is commitment. Devotion, allegiance, faithfulness. I say this for last because I feel without the word commitment, the other three words by themselves won't work. One has to be committed to be compassionate, committed to compromise, and committed to communicate with one another and God on a personal level. Well, you've heard and listened to my thoughts, but isn't this, in a broad sense, really the philosophy Jesus would want us to follow? Didn't Jesus show compassion, compromised and communicated with others throughout his life on earth? Didn't he make the biggest commitment of all, by giving his life on the cross so we could be saved? We all need to be reminded from time to time to think, act, and be more like Jesus. Remember when you became a member of Union Church? Weren't you asked similar questions about your commitment? The one question that specifically sticks out with me was, do you believe you should be a faithful member of this congregation? To share in its ministry through prayer, service, talents, support, and fulfill your calling to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. We all became stewards of God's world when we said, I will. What a statement of commitment that is. In closing, I'll leave you with some last thoughts. I ask you to think of these four words, which hinge on each other, and ask yourself, at union, haven't you received or offered compassion in some way? At Union, hasn't there been compromise? At Union, haven't we all communicated in our own way with God and each other? And finally, as a church family, haven't we all committed to support others, one another, and the church? So when making your donation, or should I say your commitment in the coming Sundays to Union, I ask you to give what you can afford, but let it be based on all that you do have and what you have received at Union Church. Think it over compassionately. Discuss it, come up with a compromise, and then commit to your decision. How much are you willing to give so that this church can continue to be a giving family? To the one who guides us and watches over us every day of our lives, to the glory of God. Amen.